going to start with a little scene from the story Not So Fast. Libby and Tim are relative strangers, though her mother and his father live together. They're both in their 80s. And Libby and Tim are on a road trip through the Fraser Canyon to an old age spa to investigate trouble in that relationship, the relationship of their parents. 4 hours into their drive, she proposes a different game. "I need to pay attention to the road," Tim demurs. "Not that kind of game," says Libby. "Not a winning game, Tim." "A game," he says. "It's the 10 things you want to hear your next spouse say game," she says. "You'll be great." "There won't be a next spouse," he says, like the principal to a naughty kindergartner. But he cuts the radio and pulls his seatbelt, then lets it slap back against his chest. "You're still eligible, Tim. The rules do not prohibit imagination in this game." "You'll probably win," he says. "No winners, no losers, and no fun unless you lighten up." He neck rolls, then tilts his head side to side, ear to shoulder. The air gets chocolatey. "Okay, how does this go?" "We alternate. I'll start. Okay, 10 things you want to hear your next spouse say." "Do I have to use that voice?" "Any voice you want." Okay, you go. "Number 10, stop, I'll hire someone to do that today." "Do what?" His hands are now welded to the fat steering wheel. "Okay, your turn," she directs. Number nine. Eventually, she leans over to look at the odometer to do the math on how long this game might take. 10 by 0.4 kilometers equals... That'd be better with a microphone, but... Why would a car need all those dials and gauges and really so many speakers in so many places? The stick shift resembles a dispatcher's vintage microphone. It's like a high-end hotel room in the cockpit of a turbojet. Pace is key, Tim, so it feels like a game. No pressure, have some fun. Sorry, okay, number 9. Let's go fishing. Ooh, nice one. Number 8, I've booked us a cheap flight to tour the spring gardens of Lake Como. Sudden acceleration. Numbers 7, 6, and 5, you've never been more right. Wow, well played, driver. Okay, your turn. Well, you took my turn. Then I took mine. Now it's your turn. Number 4, let's splurge on solar panels. Hey, listen. I know a guy who can install everything you need to power a full-size water heater, and he knows all the government subsidies and grants and shortcuts. Any extra juice, sell it to that girl next door. Call him. Wind turbines, same deal. He links you up with Aboriginal Affairs. You just need a status number or something. Tim, we're at number 3. Number 3 thing I want to hear my next spouse say, I'll drive. Hey, do you want me to drive? I assumed you wouldn't want me to drive. I feel stupid. Okay, pull over. I'll drive. I should have offered 2 hours ago. Let's switch off every hour so no one feels overwhelmed. You don't get it, he says. So true. I'd never let her drive. I want to hear her say it. I want her to want to say it so then I can refuse and make her feel protected. Libby, that's the good relationship game. Number 2, stop, I'll turn that compost while you deadhead these dahlias. There's your good relationship, Tim. Each tries to concoct the most sincere wish, the most awesome number 1, to articulate their deepest desire and profoundest request for a loving bond, to improve on relationships they've had and set guidelines for those to come, to power their ambitions. They dream big, play hard, and she will change the rules and let them both have a last turn if she can come up with a better line than his. But she can't. Number 1 thing, he says, voice clean and smooth like Nat King Cole's. Turn that off, sweetheart, and get over here. Thank you.
This last year, I had an amazing opportunity to work as a writer on a project that was being created by visual artist Dan Douglas. He has designed this immersive, interactive, augmented reality app that allows the user to kind of land in a location that once existed in Vancouver. So I got to write all these scenes that were little fragments and disconnected, disjointed little encounters with these characters throughout the building. And so I thought I'd read a couple of them now. So I'm going to just drop right into the Hotel Vancouver, into the engagement. We're going to land at Clarendon's spot. There's a wingback chair and side table beside it. Newspaper is draped over the arm of the chair and an apple rests on the side table. This is the kind of directions in the script. If we have witnessed scene 3-3, the apple has been eaten. If we have witnessed scene 3-4, there's a cup of tea also. Clarendon sits flipping through the newspaper, eating an apple. Julie approaches. Julie's a teenage shoplifter that's living in the hotel. Clarendon says, "Ah, the return of the Black Dahlia. Shut your gash, Grandpa. The paragon of feminine grace. Hey, Gazuni, I'm not here for your enjoyment. If you don't like what you see, then take the squint off." Well, if she isn't the most eligible bachelor girl at the ball, I'm eligible to nut ya if you keep flapping that big bazoo. I look forward to reading about your gruesome demise in the newspaper. She picks up the apple, takes a bite. "Excuse me, I'm eating that. Let me ask you, of you and me, who's the one that's scared of his demise, hmm? Me? I don't care how I go. I just care about doing exactly what I want all the way there. And the rest is for you. Eat up. That's the closest you'll get to a set of lips all year." She walks away. So if you wanted to, you could stick around there in that spot. And if you did, you might hear some footsteps approaching. Clarendon. Andrew. Arthur. Arthur. If you see my wife, you didn't see me. Say again. If my wife asked if you see me, you haven't, see? You mean at this moment? No, I mean if you see my wife. No, I mean... You could have avoided all this if you had simply not stopped to get my attention. I didn't know if you'd see me, but at any rate, you haven't, right? Grow nuts. What? I'm giving you some advice. Go, young man, and grow nuts. They're growing ground nuts in Tanganyika. Huh? The British government is initiating it. One of the few things they've done right lately. Ground nuts? For the oil. They'll need good men to run the operation. Take your wife. Become a plantation lord. Be rich. Where did you say? Tanganyika. Where the hell is that? Africa. My God, is there no education system in this country? Africa? To grow nuts and be eaten by lions? Sounds like hell. Aren't you a farmer? They need Canadian boys who can drive a tractor. Our farm dried up and blew away when I was 15. My family were terrible farmers, so nuts to your nuts. Or you could have followed Julie up the elevator to the 10th floor, wander down the hallways, and maybe find Betty's room. In the room remains the bare essentials of what was once a lavishly furnished hotel suite. A lady's handbag sits on a large bed that is neatly made with well-worn bedding. Some undergarments hang on makeshift line above the radiator. Assorted postcards featuring scenic beauty of Vancouver rest on a table near the window. Sound of Betty writing a letter. The door across the hall opens. There's a squawk of a bird as the door shuts behind. Julie taps the door. "Can I bug you, Betty?" "What is it?" "Julie. Julie, yes. You wouldn't happen to have any clear nail polish?" "I think so." Betty gets up to look. "Oh, I like your hair." "It's a wig." "Yes, it's a nice one. I like to keep things fresh." "Where did you get it?" "The Bay." "It smells nice in here. What is it?" Betty says, "I don't know." Julie says, "Reminds me of something, you know, when that happens, the smell, and suddenly, you know, you're at your grandma's or something." "Oh, thanks a bunch." No, I don't mean now. I don't mean you remind me of my grandma. Here you go. Thanks. I got these nylons at the Bay only yesterday, and they're starting to run. Mind if I do this here?" "No, go ahead. I could use a pair of those. So, what's the Bay?" "Apartment store. Used to be the Canadian government." "How's that?" "Never mind." You have a bird in there? Yeah, my brothers. Oh, I haven't met him yet. You're not likely to. No, the ship went down, presumed drowned. Very sorry. He had been posted in Germany after the war. I was coming back last summer. Some pals of his got me set up here through the Vets Association when I didn't have nowhere to go. I am sorry. Where will you go next? Don't know. Gonna have to choose soon, though. Place is closing. So I hear. Maybe down south or up north. Alaska seems like a good bet. Depends. Suppose if you were looking for a man, it probably is. I'm looking for freedom. Good place for that, too. Get away from the small minds and uptight times. Sounds swell. What about you? What about me? Why are you here? Just to visit. Hardly the spot for a vacation. This place ain't exactly the Ritz. It's discreet. Trying to shake someone? Trying to find someone. A friend? Not to me. Never met him. You some kind of lady dick? Hardly. Just happens to have something that belonged to my husband. Where's your husband? Same place as your brother. Bottom of the sea? Well, the details are different, but the end result is the same. Huh. Sorry. So is the man I'm looking for. I like you. You don't know me. I could, though. We're neighbors. For a while yet. I'll make the most of it. Thanks.
The story I'm going to read was published this spring in an online journal called Little Fiction. The story is short, and I'll be reading all of it, called The Goddess Lisa. What is supposed to happen is this. The sun will die. It will expand and swell, and the sand fields that were Earth's mountains and cities a billion years before will melt. Then the sun will slough off and leave behind lakes of glass. The caves, we think, where we've lasted, will linger a few more years. Though no one is in them now, because we all want to see. This, the last flare of the sun, is the shift of the millennium, of all millennia. We are out in our heat-shield suits and tinted shades on the first sandhill far enough north that we deem the temperature safe. That is, here the temperature will not reach the melting point of silica, and we can watch the sun as it dies and morphs the southern sand fields. And Lisa is here with me, with the rest of us, despite the fact she's pregnant, and her belly has stretched her heat suit to the point of ripping. She's here, and I'd rather she wasn't. The suits aren't made for two, I tell her, but she won't listen. She never has. Not last night when I told her to sleep. Not 5 months ago when she wanted to start a baby with me at the world's taper. And not right now when I wished she'd stayed in the caves, kilometers under the sand. I want this because of the baby, I tell her. I told her that earlier too, but she overruled me like always. As if she was God, the way she can go on. Lisa brushes a film of dust from her shades with her flip-off finger. She turns my way to make sure I notice. The movement crackles her suit garnet, reflecting solar sparks, and I feel torn with the nerves she's causing me. I say nothing. Already the sun is darker than usual, supple and rouge. The sky deep and brindled with day stars, constellations that in the past were hidden by a flat, young blue. Lisa stretches her arms out and up. Looking at her gleam, I want to swat her for that reach, for that risky grasp at nothing. Her suit's already so tight. To the south, the heat wavers and the dunes look alive. I'll go too, I say to Lisa. And I mean to the caves, but also, I mean sorry. Sorry that at this moment we are arguing, and sorry that we ever argued. I'll go too, I repeat, and I start to turn in token. Then Lisa grips my arm through the heat fiber, and I keep still. We wait. And while I'm still thinking of how to get Lisa below, it starts. The light hits us first, well before the heat, and I realize from the intensity that we've made a mistake. The heat will kill us, even here, at this distance, even if we had stayed in the caves. The sky's rouge purples, then blues, and brightens, and the day stars fade. There's a shiny collapse to the world, kilometers off. Lisa lets go of my arm. We spent years preparing for this, reinforcing the suits, hand layering flexible carbon cotton, soldering seams in the biofluoresce of the caverns. The heat of our blowtorch wafted sparks upward, though nowhere near the crested dome of rock. In the dirt under the earth, Lisa had teased, surreptitiously plucking yeasty-shelled fungi from the walls before they began to spore. They had more vibrancy, she claimed, and it's true, as she chewed, her mouth took on the glow of crushed phosphorus. The heat grows and starts to sear through my suit. There's a roiling, primordial flux to the sand fields. We were wrong. And now, at this point, who says what comes next? Who says what will silicate up? What might pull our fossils into something sheer and new? The sand under Lisa and me glints and shifts, and Lisa gasps. I put a hand on her, and then I gasp too, because the baby has kicked. My first baby, Lisa's first as well, and the baby's first everything. As the heat grows, the light of the dead sun dissipates and the stars shine through. So many billion years worth, a planet's lifetime worth, enough that the sky is white with them. And still, even under the pain of it all, I feel in my palm that gorgeous kick. I feel life, what we made, the goddess Lisa and I.
The piece I'm going to read is called Sarah Riel, Night Music. The one-story building made of poplar poles lies on a sandy point jutting into a large lake. Two or three islands are visible in the distance, but not the other shore. Teepees stand near. Few trees around the building. The nun, Sarah Riel, sits enclouded in gray cloth, inside at a piano, which has been carted to the outpost, great leather straps around each section, in pieces, in separate wagons and canoes, an extraordinary feat of labor that still hovers around the instrument. She is alone, an unusual circumstance for her, and she speaks to her absent brother, who is in hiding, pursued by police under threat of arrest in Eastern Canada. One, the North swallows me, its lack of individuation a mouth, a scrolling and unscrolling mouth. Rivers, lakes, pines, tundra, pines, infinite lakes. In the singing, the children climbing and slipping up their voices' inner sides, I see a fresh possibility. Fields growing edible bulbs, roads, creatures gnawing leaves, light, the books of a new country. Curled like baby mice inside the sound, we could live there. The plateau slightly above the peaks of those voices. Pelicans land on the lake. I am tubercular. But they land in truth in me. The lake where mists sit and stretch yonder, reeds at the edge, flashing sand beaches, people pushing off in barges and sail-carried canoes, few animals with their fur past finding. The smell of the wood in the chapel, it greets me. We gather children at the school, and I beckon them into tantum ergo, that special moony craft, the tubercular one. I go up with them, pelicans and reeds falling beneath us. And in winter, the lake's ice bulge will move against us. It has rained all summer, the hay is drowned. We will have no butter or milk or meat next winter. Two. My lungs poured at that particular time, two autumns back, two sloughs slumped in me, and I pooled in my bed. The upper part dry enough, however, for flares to conduct delivery of extreme unction. The priest said, pray to Marguerite Marie Alacoque. I did, and immediately asked for the return of my clothes, which the sisters had ferociously hidden. I bled, and I lived, and I doubled my soul. I returned to Potato Hills and the seeping mudroom. I ought to bury my name with my life under the snow of the cemetery. In winter, we eat only the lettuce from mother's seeds, the bed alive just inside the back door. People begin the sleigh route south to Green Lake on the ice road, then work up the stiff Beaver River. Your sister who loves you considers the silver gray road over which this piano came, skating on runners round the south tip of the big island, airlocks frozen 4 yards in the great space of ice. 3. My eye falls from the second world, smoking, but is held by a wire, so is saved from water. In this mobile, this monad with retractable green-paned wings, I have my own homunculus equipment. I smell the action of chlorophyll, and it smells me. And thus I see the skeleton of language inside deer's bodies and inside otters' swim paths. I read it, meaning it hums itself at me and around me. Oratio pro lacrimus, we would be the food of our tears. I did not make a bid on Rupert's Land. I was not a signatory to Treaty 6. I gather voices escaping from all things produced as matter, harvesting them as I would wild rice, gently tapping along their sides. Thank you.
So good to be here, and I'm going to invite Kevin to read with me. I guess this is year number 9 or something we've been doing this. Kevin's going to be Adam, who's the lead in my feature, 2 for 1, and we're going to start right at the beginning. And I'll be Miriam, but first I'll be a woman in a bedroom. So this is 2 for 1. The opening image is Adam alone in a big king-sized bed, and he's clinging to the side. Hold on, should I tell them or not? So the film starts, right? And Adam's just this guy, but you're not gonna see the whole movie. So I'll tell you that at the first act break, we discover that Adam's actually transgendered. But this woman in the bedroom does not know that he in fact has a uterus. And then Adam hooks up with Miriam and they both wind up pregnant by the midpoint. So, I'll just give you that little insider that not everybody would get when they start to watch the film. All right, so interior bedroom day. Close on a metal gadget that looks like a yardstick and a slide rule crossed. A lever's pressed, and one end of the gadget pushes against the middle of a naked, puffy mattress.
The problem is, you've only got 5 inches.
Uh-huh.
Well, it's not a problem, actually.
Reveal Adam in the bedroom. He wears a shirt, tie, dress pants, and a name tag over his pocket that reads Adam, Mattress King. He kneels on the queen-size mattress. A young woman watches him intently as he prods the mattress with his measuring gadget.
It just means that your mattress is not considered defective as per the Slumber King warranty.
When does it become a problem?
When you've got 10 or 12 inches.
He gets up off the bed and demonstrates 12 inches on the mattress say gadget. Right, I can see how that would be a problem.
4 or 5 inches is considered normal. Disappointing, but normal.
Uh-huh.
That's the breaking in margin we expect from our mattresses. The money back guarantee only applies for 10 or more inches.
He walks around the mattress as if sizing it up.
Well, what should I do? It's too mushy.
Can I ask you a personal question?
Yeah.
If you sleep in the middle of the bed, you'd probably find it firm.
That's the question. How do you know where I sleep?
Trade secret. Ladies tend to cling to the edges and gentlemen lie in the middle.
What other secrets do you know?
That. And your sag is significant on this side.
He moves to the opposite side and he presses down.
Yeah, see? Firmer.
So the woman sits next to Matt Adam and she looks up at him inviting. Smash cut to interior bedroom moments later. Adam and the woman are entwined. They kiss passionately, messily. The woman tries to unbutton his shirt. She has a hard time concentrating on the task, but she manages to peel it off while still staying affixed to Adam at the lips. He pulls her top off over her head, and then he stops as if coming to.
But maybe we should, this is moving a bit fast.
She slinks out of her skirt.
I gotta tell you something.
She grabs his face with both hands and shuts him up with her mouth.
No, seriously, there's something you need to know before we go.
Can't it wait?
No. No, absolutely not.
I don't care if you're married.
No, God, no, I'm not.
Just shut up and beep, beep, say the sensors. Mr. 12 inches.
Listen.
Smash cut to interior hallway moments later. Close on Adam standing in the doorway of the woman's apartment, disappointed.
Listen.
The door slams in his face. He tries to regain his composure. He hurls his briefcase on the ground.
Beep. Beep me.
Adam's phone rings. He doesn't check the number, he just answers.
Yes.
And it's Miriam. Thank God you answered.
How did you get this number?
Interior, Miriam's bedroom, intercut. Continuous. Miriam, late 30s, 40, is a disaster waiting to happen. She sits on her bed in a worn bathrobe, hair akimbo, holding a FedEx box. There's just nobody else I could trust. You said you'd always be there for me.
Miriam, that was before. Miriam. As per usual, you're nuts.
It's a matter of life and death, Adam.
Whose life?
I don't know who else I can count on. I mean, always, you said always. What does commitment mean to you?
Commitment? You're talking to me about commitment? What part of non-monogamy involves commitment?
Polyamory.
Whatever.
She wails out a cry and Adam's mouth hangs open. Please, Adam, please, I have nobody else. He hangs up. Cut to interior Miriam's front door day. The door opens on Adam and Miriam stands at the door. She slinks to the ground and in her ratty house coat. Thank God you're here. She pulls him through the threshold and Miriam slams the door. He just stares at her waiting. Oh my God, I am so fucked. She starts crying again, sliding down the door, head in hands. I'm running out of time. I don't know what to do. He's immobile and he watches her toe tapping.
The emergency?
Ugh.
Espresso? Or tequila.
Interior day, Miriam's kitchen. An empty shot glass slams on the table. Miriam with a small white espresso cup in her other hand. She downs the espresso in one gulp, and she opens the tequila and fills the espresso cup with it. She downs a second shot. Adam, arms crossed, keeps his distance. Miriam gestures to the tequila bottle, looks at Adam. Come on, don't let me drink alone.
I'm on a break from work.
You got a job? You, Adam Bachman? He hands her business card. Mattress warranty technician. Very impressive, Mr. Bachman.
Yeah, it's the bomb. Talk about a dream job. I spend my day in strange women's bedrooms.
Mattress king. Do they know?
Miriam, the emergency?
Oh, right.
Life or death, you don't appear to be dying?
She shows him a blue plastic stick from her pocket, and he stares at it. It has a happy face and a window on the stick.
You're pregnant?
Ugh, I wish. No, I'm just ovulating. Adam pours himself some tequila. They say within 24 hours, but I think it should happen sooner. You know, like in a few hours. She lights a cigarette.
Ovulating.
Finally!
So then...
I'm trying, and the hormones are driving me crazy. Oh. She huffs on the cigarette, grabs a FedEx box. I can't do this alone. You're the only one I trust. She cuts the tape on the box.
What about your wife?
We didn't actually wind up getting married in the end. She takes the lid off the box. And it arrived today, and I've been planning for months, and I just, I can't. I didn't think I'd be this scared, you know?
When did you break up?
We didn't.
So you're going to be non-monogamous freaking parents?
Polyamorous. The thing is, you know, I never expected this. I guess I realized how important making a family is to me, and I didn't expect to have cold feet. When the courier showed up, I freaked. I mean, it's $800. It'll thaw and be no good. Today's the day. Beep. She pulls out the rainbow-covered box from the pack, from the package.
Could that be more gay?
It's donor home delivery. He looks at the rainbow box and then at the happy face.
Donor like souvlaki?
No, stupid. Donor like sperm. Thank you.
Okay, so I'm going to read three poems for you all today. The first poem, there's a few points you need to know. Thera and Santorini mean the same thing. They're interchangeable names for the same place, a Greek island. Santorini has a volcano on it, and in the middle to late Bronze Age, it had a huge eruption that pretty much wiped out the Minoan civilization. And Akrotiri is just a name of a preserved Minoan ruin on Thera. So, the features of Thera, pulsating, 2009. Once it was you, me, and purple crocus flowers. Pulling apart weeds with our dirty hands, with outstretched arms, would be the last time we destroyed something together so that something else could grow. I turn to you and see the Aegean flashing in your eyes. Do you see it in mine? A type of wild blaze in amongst my diluted pupils. In the Athenaeus harbor, we scaled the high cliffs to our hostel. The tip of the great volcano and the tip of lost Atlantis, some say. Plato's drawings are eerily accurate, a circular island town. We succumbed to the slow peel of the bleach blue tide pulling out against Thera's black sand as the saffron gatherers labor in the distance. Here, the Minoans still pulse and press against the beat of late night discos and full moon parties. Against throngs of tourists trapped in the maze of white, against cheap euros and overpriced cocktails. Akrotiri is strong and stoic against the wind, all of her stones held together by scholars who don't make nearly enough. Here, we lay out in the sun and burn, skin becoming red and tight. Here, we wonder how silent it would have been with all that volcanic ash slowly raining down. How to deal with self-doubt. Let doubt in like an old friend coming over for dinner. Wine and dine it. Get doubt drunk off of a 92 Cabernet Sauvignon, a very good year. Stuff it full of filet mignon and asparagus, duck fat roasted potatoes and chocolate souffle. Take its car keys when it's too sauce to drive. Talk late into the night with it. Pour it an Earl Grey and give it a foot rub. Share your most embarrassing moments. Gossip. Tell doubt about your hopes and your dreams and your crippling fears. Feel close to doubt with lingered glances and knee grazing. Let doubt feel close to you. On your couch in front of a fire, slowly whisper into its ear, lick its nape. Seduce it. Lead it to your bedroom and dim the lights. Strip for it. Reveal the cosmos of yourself that is stretched across aching muscle and brittle bone as a skin. Point to the scar on your left foot you got in Japan. Point to the cellulite on your thighs under your butt. Force its hands to feel your pubic hair, the same hair he pulled when you said no, and flex your incapable fingers that can't seem to ejaculate elegant, intelligent poetry, no matter how many times you jack off. Straddle on top of doubt and let doubt in. Tie up its hands and feet, make doubt submit to you. And then fuck the shit out of doubt, fuck it hard. Make it come over and over and over until it is exhausted, raw, and conquered, less smoking a Belmont, belly up on your sweat-stained sheets.
I'm afraid of your bell as well. This is an egg. Go! This is an excerpt from a memoir in progress called either Look Back to Galilee, The Shouting Fence, or Who Killed the Kibbutz? When people ask why, at the age of 20, I dropped out of university to join a commune in Israel, I often reply, look at my wrist. There you can read a faded map of my past, a thin white scar that runs as straight as the Jordan River. It's all that remains aside from the odd arthritic pang of what I call my old college football injury, which is true up to a point. Fact, I fractured the wrist on my right hand during my first semester at Carleton U.
a little macho deflating context, had been playing touch football in the snow with journalism students. Still, that bad break meant months in a cast and then a screw and a bone graft. A second cast nixed my plans to join my hometown high school sweetheart when she went tree planting in northern Alberta. This was an earlier, more disconnected era, pre-cell phone, pre-internet, pre-text message. Our relationship would live or die on the wings of Canada Post. So I taught my left hand to touch type soppy love letters, care of some remote PO box in the boreal forest. I kept mailing them, even when the replies diminished and stopped entirely. Even when her 1 month stint in the woods stretched into two, into three, into the whole summer. Even when my second cast came off and revealed an emaciated albino forearm shaded by a coat of brown fur, like a Wookiee on a hunger strike. Even when I could no longer ignore the obvious, the truth stung. My hometown high school sweetheart had soured on our saccharine dreams and upgraded to someone new. He was, I would learn, 10 years my senior, and worst of all, an artist. He had a thing for dinosaurs and topless chorus girls, which he depicted in collages slopped together from marbles, airplane glue, and dismembered Barbie dolls. He had once been a heroin junkie, but now only drank till his eyeballs turned yellow. How could I compete? I considered pulling a full Lancelot, stealing my parents' Malibu Classic, and driving across the continent to win her back. Friends talked me down from this fantasy. Dude, they told me, get over her. But well, it wasn't that easy. I had a broken heart, an aching wrist, and enough money for another year of tuition or a transatlantic plane fare. I chose door number two and bought a ticket to Israel. Before I left, my high school buddies threw a party in the same townhouse basement where, every Friday night for the past 3 years, we had gathered to shotgun six packs of beer, watch a VHS bootleg of The Breakfast Club, and renew the great Ali Sheedy versus Molly Ringwald debate that had paralyzed a generation. My visits to this subterranean circus of hormonal discontent had become less frequent ever since a near-fatal screening. The host had notched an arrow into the drawn string of his dad's composite bow and drunkenly flourished it at my forehead as a joke. There might be less stupid ways to die than getting William Tell'd at a Breakfast Club marathon with a can of Labatt's Blue in your hand, but I can't think of one on the spot. For a goodbye guest, my friends had handcrafted a joint the size of a baby's arm. Sadly, they knew as much about street drugs as they did about contemporary cinema. That fat wand of tobacco was so parsimoniously seeded with rat turds of low-grade suburban hash that it was less a monster joint than the representation of a monster joint, the dim platonic shadow of a mega doobie. It didn't matter. They had only rolled it for the placebo effect. Even on this muted buzz, the night soon tilted out of control. Upstairs in the bathroom, I could hear another buddy, and future tar sands geologist, was snorting lines of Drano. Whoa, he observes, it's like my nostrils dissolving. I passed around an address book for postcards I would never write. A week later, in the departure zone of Mirabel Airport, an Israeli security agent from LL scattered the contents of my backpack across a steel table. On public display, the net worth of my now transient life ranged from the pretentious, an uncracked edition of James Joyce's Ulysses, to the pathetic, long bandoliers of Trojan condoms. Hope, amongst other things, sprang eternal. But it was my address book that piqued the agent's suspicion. He pointed to an open page and asked, "Who is Masood Falsometer?" I blanked. I'd never heard the name before. What was it doing in my book? Then I recognized the handwriting. Under the letter F, my Drano-headed Fred had scribbled an Arabic-sounding pseudonym. I explained to the skeptical guard that really, honestly, I didn't know a Mr. Falsometer, that no, he hadn't given me any packages to transport, that in fact, he probably didn't exist, that the person who had entered the address was a Kyle from Quebec, not a Masood from the Middle East, that the name was a gag. Falsometer, get it? A joke at my expense. His glare darkened. What kind of joke is that? Good question. How could I explain to this dour gatekeeper the emotionally stunted rituals of the North American male? I barely understood them myself. At the party, I had tried to leave early, but the host wouldn't let me. He was a drunken archer, an aspiring policeman, a future lawyer,
and my closest approximation to a best friend. He grappled me in a sumo hold and demanded I stay. Robert Bly and Iron John were still 2 years off, so this is what had to pass for a man hug in the late 80s. I resisted, he resisted Bath. We caromed off kitchen counters and through the screen door and off the back porch and into the meager yard of his absentee parents. We scrummed until I felt too tired to care and I went limp. And we staggered backwards and crashed through the sliding metal doors of the garden shed. There we lay, panting, limbs tangled amid corroded rakes and pruning shears. Our fraternal farewell consummated in blood, he dusted off his jeans and left me sprawled in the dark. At least, I thought, pinned in the broken embrace of a Canadian Tire cabana, hypnotized by the dance of the autumn stars above me, at least wherever I might be going couldn't be any more fucked up than where I was leaving. Of course, even about this, I was so very wrong.
I'm going to read from Little Empress. A long time ago in a land far, far away, I was an ESL teacher to some lovely little Chinese students, so thought I would share some of my experiences with you this evening. Yesterday, on her way out of class, Tina stopped at my desk. Miss Dion, do you like to wear a skirt? I am wearing a skirt, Tina, I said, looking down at her and pointing to the floral pattern reaching to my ankles. No, Miss Dion, a short skirt. You want me to wear a short skirt? She nodded, her apple cheeks beaming. Okay, Tina, I'll see what I can do. This morning, I wear a short wraparound skirt in response to Tina's request. I don't usually teach in short skirts, what with all the jumping and crouching I have to do for this job, but I thought I'd make an exception for today. It isn't scandalously short, though. It comes to just above my knees, and for good measure, I'm wearing a pair of black opaque tights. Still, I'm surprised at how self-conscious I feel on the walk to work. Passing the old men and the hairdressers and the potato vendor, I keep smoothing the skirt down and holding it closed against the wind, which seems determined to rip it open or flip it up in the back. I arrive at the school and dash up to the classroom before anyone can see me. Connie arrives a few minutes later and does a double take when she sees what I'm wearing. Oh, this is different. Is it bad? I asked, worried. No, it's good, it's new. I think the kids will like it. As Tina strolls in for her class, she surveys my outfit and gives me an approving nod. Jerry, however, waltzes in and lets out a loud guffaw. As he sits down, he bellows in Cantonese for all the class to hear. Miss Dion's clothing is not balanced. The sweater is too big and the skirt is too small. Thanks, Jerry, I mutter over my clipboard as Connie relays his message. Later, in the middle of the lesson, Jerry blurts out, Miss Dion's sweater is like a big dinner, and her skirt is the dessert. The entire class giggles and twitters. Jerry, I say, exasperated as Connie translates his comments, enough! Near the end of class, as everyone is practicing today's dialogue with a partner, Jerry turns to me and says, in perfect English, Miss Dion, your skirt is very short. A bad man can whoop. On the word whoop, he makes a hand going up a skirt motion and laughs like a maniac. Jerry! I don't know if I should praise him for his spontaneous and creative use of the language or scold him for being a cheeky little perv. So I'll tell you one more story about Jerry. Jerry was about 12 years old, a little chubby, really funny kid, really outspoken. His parents eventually moved to Hong Kong, which I think was a good thing, because I think if he'd stayed in China, he might have got in trouble. He had a lot of opinions. Jerry accompanies me through the alleyway to the grocery store behind number one school. As we walk between rows of tightly parked bicycles, he teaches me to count to 10 in Cantonese. Ya yi sam say m lak chak pak gao sa. Ya yi sam say m, I repeat, trailing off after number 5. He tries again. I manage to finish 6 through 10. He claps loudly and says, good, Miss Dion, good. At the end of the alleyway, we look up and see the steel gates of the grocery store shut and locked. We glance at each other. Oh no! We go to a small shop at the other end of the street. As I pay for a bottle of water, the woman at the cash asks Jerry who I am. My English teacher, he says in Cantonese, buffing his fingernails on his t-shirt and inspecting them. From Canada. He names all of the colors at the checkout in English and begins counting in English as we leave the store. The next day, Jerry announces to his entire class that I usually go to the store after their lesson. So, after their lesson, the entire class follows me there. I feel like the Pied Piper or the Colonel Sanders in the mural over at the KFC as I lead 20 children through the alleyway past the old bicycle attendant. At the store, the kids surround the ice cream freezer. I like, they chant, then whine, Miss Dion, please. I check my wallet. Oh, okay. As I pay for the frozen mountain of paddle pops, the cashier gives me a look that says, boy, they sure got your number. Outside on the step, the class swarms me as I dole out ice cream bars. Breaking from the pack, Edgar dashes across the street to where his father is waiting for him on a motorbike. He shows the ice cream to his dad as he hops up behind him. His father waves to me. Oh, ice cream, he shouts in English. You are a good teacher for the children. Good teacher? Possibly. Complete pushover? Definitely.
I'm going to read from an old play, and I'm going to read something I've never read before from it. The play is called 2000, and I wrote it about the millennium, so it's kind of my end of the world play. The first act begins the same way the second act does. Sean and Wynn are in bed. Sean, the husband, is sound asleep. Wynn speaks to the audience. In the first act, she tells the story of a cougar that runs in the middle of the night over the Second Narrows Bridge and into the Pacific Coliseum, which is actually partly a true story. The second act also begins by her sitting up in bed, her husband sound asleep, and she tells this story. A brother and sister lived together in a basement apartment in Victoria. One spring morning, the sister was getting ready for work. She was brushing her hair in front of a mirror. The first thing she heard was the screech of brakes, and then men yelling. And then she sees him, framed by the living room window, framed by her mirror. The cougar is frantic. His yellow eyes blink back fear. And she knows in an instant what the cougar is going to do. As the woman slips into the hall closet, the cougar comes crashing through the window. She watches him through the slats. He lands squarely on the coffee table, shards of glass trembling from his beautiful ears, a bead of blood beneath his eye. And then he is shot by the man at the window. They had been following him down Quadra Street as he ran against the rush hour traffic, as he pounded the sidewalk toward what he hoped was home. The woman, who had been brushing her hair, watched the cougar fall, and as he fell, her back slid down the wall of the closet, and she feared a bullet had entered her own heart. But this is the part I like the best. The story is on the news, of course, local, national. People love this story. I learn about it on the radio, an interview with the brother who sounds soft-spoken and terrified. This was his statement. I thought it would be better if I just stayed in my room. Who were these two, this brother and sister, living in a basement apartment on Quadra Street? They're probably into metal, or the lottery, or speed knitting. But I imagine her nudging 40, brushing her hair, the gray just starting. Her hair is heavy and strong, and she holds it back with a pair of yellow combs. She works in an office. She buys knickknacks for their immaculate basement apartment. A sunburst clock, a dish towel covered in ducks. She lives with her brother, because she always has. They are a pair. Maybe he needs a little help, so they help each other. The fame the cougar brings them is short-lived, of course, but it is still the most important thing that will happen in their lives. There's no children, but the woman, she is settled with this. She doesn't feel hollow and windswept. So although there will be no grandchildren to tell the story of the cougar to, this pair still share it with each other. Even in silence, they know what happened, and there is a lot of silence between them. But it is only that, silence. They are kind to each other, and because they are not married, they haven't learned how to use silence as a weapon. I seem to have completely lost the knack for being happy. I know we can't be happy very often. I don't think I'm expecting that. But even just a year ago, I had my hopeful list about the approaching millennium, and that sense of hope, it was as real as my hand. Wynne examines her hand for a moment, and then she winds up and she belts her husband as hard as she can on the head. He sits up abruptly and he yells out in fear, "Ah!" She comforts him. "Sweetheart, you're okay. There, you were having an awful dream." I was? I don't remember a thing. Well, that's the way with dreams, isn't it? Everything rich and real, and then bang, whack, all gone, blackout. Thank you.
I'm going to read tonight from a piece in progress, and it's called Fallen. When we get to Ashford Manor, it's already mid-morning. We find my dad sitting in one of the plushy armchairs in the living room. Two or three other residents slump on sofas near him, staring at the television. Next to our father perches Mary. She suffers from dementia, but she has a full-blown crush on Dad. She follows him everywhere, much to his bewilderment. "What does he want?" he asks. Here he is, our dad, closing in on 86, even though for 60 years he threatened that his five children would spark an early heart attack. "You'll kill me yet," he'd holler after one of our misdemeanors, clutching his chest dramatically every time we did something wrong. Here he is, the guy who once brought home 100 pounds of overripe bananas from the Lestock auction mart, and couldn't understand why my mother was not thrilled by such a bargain. Here he sits, the guy who drunkenly drove us into a snowbank after my cousin Norma's January wedding, and we all had to walk 3/4 of a mile home in our party shoes. Have you ever walked home in a snowbank in patent leather shoes? Not nice. Here he sits, the guy who wanted both of his sons to be NHL stars, and then to come home and run the family farm. The guy whose poetic repertoire of swear words based on sexual body parts, mostly those of women, silenced everyone at any meeting, everywhere. Here he sits, the source of most of the upheaval in our family's life, hands folded, in his lap, head back, mouth open, gently napping. "Dad, look at you," I say. In the old days, we'd have said, "What does the other fellow look like?" He sits up slowly, cranes his neck like an ancient turtle. "What?" he asks. As I write this, I'm looking at my cell phone, at the pictures I took of his injuries. We don't suspect foul play, but just for the record, we have these four photos. The first shows my dad in profile as he lies on his bed. From his right side, his aquiline nose pokes out in sharp relief. His bruised cheekbone glowers. Down to his elbow, which has been bandaged by Sophia, the manager of Ashford Manor, who was once a doctor in her homeland of Afghanistan. For the third photo, up to his right hand, covered by three big burgundy bruises, the largest of which is shaped a bit like Australia. Then back to his nose, the one my sister has inherited, to show the cut along its bridge. He must have had his glasses on, we speculate, must have been wearing them when he fell. What happened? My sister asks repeatedly as she tidies him up. How did you fall, Dad? Dunno, he replies, not terribly interested. Night staff heard a noise from his room around 2 a.m., found him, battered but standing, between his bed and the door to his bathroom. The morning attendant noted a pool of blood. She's outraged that the night staff had left it for her to clean up. What's this? Dad says, fingering the white adhesive tape already peeling away from his elbow. What's that? He asks, prodding the bruises on his hand. Initially, we see no signs of misadventure in the bathroom, but my sister soon detects a long streak of dried blood on the corner of the sink. I wet a paper towel and scrub it away, but I worry that I'm somehow destroying evidence. Thank you.